Hey everyone, welcome to this week's release of the Hashrate Happy Hour podcast. On today's show, my guest is Kevin Koba. Kevin is the Economic Development Manager at Otter Tail Power Company. They are an investor-owned electric utility company that provides electricity and energy services for just over 133,000 people. They have a service territory that spans roughly 70,000 square miles, spread out throughout Minnesota, South Dakota, and North Dakota, where their mission is to produce and deliver electricity as reliably and economically to improve the quality of life in the areas they served. Interestingly, Otter Tail Power Company is also known in the Midwest for having one of the largest Bitcoin mining hosting companies as one of their largest customers. On today's show, Kevin and I will talk through the recent legislative sessions that include tax incentives for Bitcoin mining, how Otter Tail Power is working with some of the local economies to help them understand Bitcoin mining and data center industries, and how that can help them drive economic growth, and how Otter Tail Power has identified that Bitcoin mining is an integral part of the future and is a part of the unprecedented load growth that they are currently experiencing. This conversation is by far one of my favorites, and I walked away from it very excited about the future of Bitcoin mining and how it will continue to play a key role in the future of the electric utility industry. So with that, I hope you enjoy today's show with Kevin Koba. Hey everyone, welcome back to the show. Like I said in the introduction, I'm here with Kevin Koba with Otter Tail Power Company. Kevin, welcome to the show.
Hey Ben, it's great to see you again, and it's great to be on your podcast this morning. Thanks for the invite.
Oh, absolutely. Really excited to have you on. I'm looking forward to jumping in and talking through some of the cool stuff that Otter Tail's got going on, especially in the Bitcoin mining space. So actually, what I'd love to hear about, Kevin, you've been super busy the last handful of weeks here. You've been at the state capitol in South Dakota in Pierre. What's going on in Pierre, and what are you spending all your time doing?
Well, it's it's interesting you bring that up. For your listeners, I do spend about 2.5 months in Pierre. I've been as a lobbyist for Otter Tail Power Company, along with my other duties, my real job. I call this my vacation from my real job. And if anybody wants a vacation recommendation, don't do lobbying. I'd certainly advise you to do something that's less chaotic and less stressful. But so I've been doing that now since full time in South Dakota since about 2001. And so basically what I do is we have an association in South Dakota, South Dakota Electric Utility Companies. And that's made up of the 6 investor-owned electric and gas companies in South that serve the customers in South Dakota. So we have an association, and then myself and a few others are provide assistance to our executive director in that regard. So we are out there pretty much the entire session. This year, a lot of things that could potentially impact our company and the other 6 utilities, along with a lot of the utilities in general, whether it's electric, natural gas, telecom, you name it, is there's a significant bill passages in regards to eminent domain. And we utilize eminent domain very rarely when we're looking to build projects out, for example, transmission lines. It's kind of the option of last resort if we can't come to conclusions with the landowners along the route. They're looking at doing some significant eminent domain reform coming from landowners, and we all get that. We all understand what they're faced with when they're looking at people looking to locate facilities on the land. But this, all the eminent domain bills that are out there are being brought to really address the Summit Carbon pipeline that maybe some of your listeners are familiar with, but that is the CO2 pipeline that is being looked at to pipe CO2 to a underground storage in North Dakota. So that goes right through our service territory, right through the state of South Dakota, right up into North Dakota. So everybody's really watching that. Just for listeners' interest, if there is any, that's the biggest issue out in South Dakota for us right now, along with, you know, how do we spend IRA money, the Inflation Reduction Act money. We're going to look at that very seriously. Can we utilize that for infrastructure upgrades and things like that? And grid hardening is another one that's gotten real popular. Last year we tried to do a tax incentive bill for crypto and Bitcoin, probably the same. But so we tried to do a tax incentive for that to try to make South Dakota a little bit more competitive with the surrounding states. When I say that, South Dakota is a great state to do business in. Tax climate is probably second to none in the country. But we were looking at, you know, some of these mining facilities, and really what I wanted to take a look at is how could we give an incentive to smaller data miners? Mm-hmm. Oftentimes we talk about the large, you know, huge facilities, 20, 30, 50, 100, and even 500 megawatt facilities. We also have a lot of, you know, in the garage, residential Bitcoin miners out there that want to expand. And so we were looking, that's really what I was focused on. We ran into some real hurdles with that, with revenue reduction, and, you know, we're a low tax state. So anytime you start taking a run at a tax exemption, you get a lot of agencies looking at that saying, whoa, we're going to erode our tax base. And we, you know, probably, so we ran into some roadblocks. We do have programs in South Dakota for these types of things. They're discretionary, which is what I was trying to get around, make it more, you know, so that any small data miner could be eligible for a tax exemption up front on equipment and such. We weren't able to do that. We still have the discretionary fund that, you know, we can utilize for the data miners that are interested in that, just to kind of get them, if they're going to get in the game early, it makes them a little bit more competitive, can cut down, you know, some of those initial costs for equipment and things. So
yeah,
and that we didn't bring that back this year. So
sure. And sorry to jump in when you say, no, you know, a discretionary fund. So you said that was kind of around some tax incentives. Could you maybe touch on what you mean by the discretionary part? Is that just,
sure,
shed some light on that?
Our in South Dakota, we have what's called the Governor's Office of Economic Development, or GOED. It's called GOED, and that's directly a cabinet under the governor. And they have a number of programs in under GOED that they can offer different incentives, financing, types of things. And there is a program that allows for a sales tax refund for certain businesses that we attract to South Dakota. There's an economic development. It's kind of like a board that takes the applications from those types of businesses and reviews them, and then determines whether or not they're eligible for the tax rebate, essentially, is what it is. So,
okay.
Very popular program, but you know, we haven't seen it being utilized. And I've been in touch with the people at GOED. They're very open to taking a look at each and any, you know, that we bring forth. So,
sure. And so would, with the current program that's in place, Bitcoin mining crypto companies are not able to tap into that, or it's just a little bit more difficult with the way it is in place right now?
No, they're all eligible. They would just have to apply. Yeah.
Oh, okay. Okay. So what then, you had mentioned you're looking at, and you tried last year to get more tax incentives pushed through. Are you able to share what that looks like, or what more could be added to that?
Yeah. You know, what we were attempting to do is provide for an ongoing sales tax exemption on the equipment that the miners were installing. And then, you know, each like 2 to 3 years when they had to upgrade, they could, again, it would be basically a perpetual rebate on their sales tax on that equipment. It's a big step. I mean, it's a lot of tax dollars that would be going out. But you know, our point was we don't have it now. So our revenues weren't there from this sales tax, and so if we don't have it, you're not missing it. But if we could get something like that, and again, going back, my focus was really the small guys, a megawatt, not small by any means in our book. Yeah. But those are the ones that are really trying to locate in spots where it's the least cost to open up their doors. And, let's give them a break. We always focus, the programs that a lot of states have for incentives are, it's really large business. And again, these are small entrepreneurs that want to get into the business. And I think my thoughts at that time and still are, hey, we got to work with these people too. Let's give them an incentive to, locate in our state and eventually possibly they can become a bigger player. And that's a good thing for the state. So.
Oh, absolutely. Very cool. You mentioned it didn't get passed last year. Is the sentiment coming from the Capitol not friendly towards it, or were there just some things in there they thought maybe we can modify and then bring it back in front of them? What was kind of behind the not passing?
Anytime you bring a tax incentive, whether it's in, we don't have an income tax in South Dakota. So anytime you start bringing in a tax exemption, and there's tax exemptions all over in state statute and in South Dakota, along with any other state, right? So, but without an income tax, we have an appropriations group within the legislature that is very concerned. We have to bring in so much money to meet our budget and be able to pay for things. So if you continually bring in these exemptions, it's an erosion on that tax base. So that was the biggest issue. There just wasn't an appetite for it at that time. And we thought about bringing it back this year too. There's a lot of money out there. Mm-hmm. So I don't know, but we won't, it's too late to do it now. We may look at it down the road if we find that, it evolves into something that we start bringing in and then all of a sudden the competition is such that, what can you do for us? What types of things do you have available? The discretionary part is just, it's a hard one, because then you're picking a winner here, maybe a loser there. And so that's where I think the Gov's office is looking at those larger projects where they can get the biggest bang from the buck. It's a smaller fund. It's not a wide open multi-million dollar fund. So if you keep eroding at that, then it eventually it just gets to be where it could go away. And we don't want that to happen because that is definitely a tool for the governor's office to utilize in business attraction and retention. So that's really what it was. It was just not that appetite to erode at that tax base anymore. Yeah. So,
got it. What I find so fascinating about this, Kevin, is that you yourself are down at the Capitol having these discussions, bringing this type of stuff to legislation, and you work for Otter Tail Power Company. That to me, at least, seems so forward thinking for a utility company. How is it, or maybe when was it that yourself or Otter Tail started to take this approach with Bitcoin mining, crypto? Do you know when exactly it was that you guys started to get this type of interest where you're going to the Capitol to promote that?
Was pretty obvious to me. It happened about 2 years ago. We had done some work with a very large mining operation in North Dakota, and North Dakota meets every 2 years for their legislative session. So it had been 2 years ago they passed legislation in North Dakota to do this very thing, provide these tax sales tax rebate to they had initially had this type of legislation years ago, and then they had capped it at like 3 or 4 clients or customers, and it basically had gone away. That was probably, you know, during the oil boom, the last oil boom in North Dakota. And so North Dakota had really gotten great appetite for mining operations and data. And so they brought it back to the legislature. My predecessor, actually, in this job, was one of the people that was really instrumental in getting it going and getting it passed in South Dakota. Or in North Dakota, I'm sorry. So they brought this very legislature, we modeled ours after theirs, brought it to their legislature 2 years ago, got it passed. And so, you know, there's an old joke or an old saying that says, I know a good joke when I steal one. I basically said the same thing here. I know a good program when we can steal one. We don't have to reinvent it. Let's give it a shot in South Dakota, see what we can do. It's, again, one of those things about trying to stay competitive. And that, you know, I'll emphasize again, we're very competitive in South Dakota, especially tax-wise. I just, you know, it had been something where I thought personally and had the support of the utility industry, let's do something a little extra to see what we can do.
Oh, that's so cool. You're moving in the direction I wanted to go next, which was the very large Bitcoin mining customer that you guys have on your grid. Can you say more about that?
Yeah, you know, this is really how it got started for Otter Tail. I mean, I bet it was prior to becoming the economic development manager at Otter Tail. I was an area manager in Millbank for 25 plus years, and basically my job was customer service and operations for Otter Tail in South Dakota, and then it expanded to some territory in Minnesota, some territory in North Dakota. But it happened, it was probably 5 years ago, between 5 and 7 years ago, I'd received a call from a company out of Las Vegas. And they initially said, hey, we're looking to move up to the Midwest and we need 500 megawatts of capacity. And I thought, oh my gosh, that's half of our baseload generation. I got, you know, of course, anytime you get a 500 megawatt customer, you go, wow, let's sign them up right now. Yeah. Right. So, but I had no idea what it was. And so I passed it on again to some people at Otter Tail that our economic development director at that time, and then upper management, and said, here's a customer wants to do 500 megawatts. I have no idea what it is. I know we can't locate it on our system anywhere. But eventually that turned into a further conversation where other people at Otter Tail said, well, we can't do 500, but maybe we could do 1050s. And so that's really where we proceeded with the conversation. And that was a couple years ago, maybe 3 years ago. And then we started working with some of these clients, like the one that we have in that we eventually ended up locating in Jamestown. Now it's Applied Digital, right?
Yep.
They came online through a ton of iterations of working with different people, different companies that were looking at trying to find spots to locate for data mining. And we were successful in working with them. And I think it was January of 2021, they came online. They were a 100 megawatt customer of ours at the time we signed them up on, they signed the electric service agreement. They became our second largest customer.
At the snap of the finger, you know, just so, like that. That's pretty cool.
Yeah. So, and it's just been a great relationship with them. So we're looking forward to that. One of the things that's really interesting is, you know, it's incredible how much we're a small utility, right? We have relatively small, you know, 130,000 customers and 70,000 square mile service territory. I joke that we have 2 customers per square mile. you know, so we're very small, and consequently we're very limited resource wise, right? So these projects just take a ton of resources and a ton of human resources. So our folks just from, you know, initially my contacts with the customers to bringing in our sales department to help them to, you know, understand our rate structures and then bringing in engineers to do the study, the transmission studies. And then you're bringing in the generation people to, okay, how can we do 100 megawatts and are we going to be able to provide that power to them? It just takes a ton of time and human resources. So, you toss in a couple other projects for a company like Otter Tail Power. All of a sudden people are going, you know, no moss, give us some time. Let's get our breath here.
Sure.
And for me as an economic developer, I'm going, oh, come on now.
We have an opportune time
here.
Yeah.
Yeah. We have an opportune time to do something that in our 120 plus year history is unprecedented. And so, but we'll get through that. I'm certain we will. So we've been working with what I've been doing for probably the last 2 years, and it's almost strictly been focusing on data and data centers and data mining, is trying to find locations in our service territory. I basically call them sweet spots in our service territory. We have the ability to site, whether it's a large data mining facility or a large customer in general. Where's the capacity at? What does the transmission system look like? How's our generation stack going to be able to do this? And so that's really been a focus of mine for the last couple of years. And I know we're a small company. Our average town size of 130,000 customers, our average town size is 400 people. So those communities, like everyone I'm sure that's listening knows, you know, they used to probably be bigger, and they used to probably have a lot of things going on in their towns, and some of those things have gone away.
Yeah.
But we still have the infrastructure in place, right? So stranded assets, if you will. So how can we utilize that to attract customers and help our small town economic developers, our small town city councils, our small town, you know, mayors go, okay, here, you know, if you want our help, and they all do, here's what we have, and here's what we have available. All of our communities, whether it's Minnesota, South Dakota, or North Dakota, work very diligently as diligently as they can based upon their resources with the state government entities, such as the GOED in South Dakota, North Dakota Department of Commerce, Minnesota DEED, where those entities will get inquiries from companies, data companies, for example, that want to look at maybe one of the three states or maybe all three states. So they send out an RFI or a request for information, and it goes out to all the communities. And what I find in my traveling is not all communities can do these things, right? And so if we can go to them and let them know up front, mm-hmm. okay, here's what we can do for you. Do you have the capacity to do X? You can't respond to, you know, a company that's looking for 50 megawatts and a natural gas if you don't have it. So we just want to try to get those communities to know their utility companies so that they can be educated. They don't all of a sudden go out looking for a building and purchase a building when they know that it can't be done. So that's really what I've been doing, is trying to find those communities, let them know what they've got available to them. And then when those RFIs come out, they can respond in an educated way, and they can sort, and they don't have to respond to them all. So,
yeah. And what is the response, you know, maybe just broad stroke of the towns that you're talking to and bringing this to, what is their response to data centers, Bitcoin mining? You know, what are they saying? That's crazy. We don't want that here. Or are they receptive to it?
It's been a really mixed bag, Ben. You know, when I did when I was working on the tax incentives in South Dakota, the response was, whoa, wait a second, this scares the living daylights out of me. There was some negatives from, there was just it was just the unknown of data mining, really. People didn't know what it was. When you talk crypto, and I don't necessarily know it, I don't know everything a lot about it. But when you bring it up in front of a legislator and say, we want to give crypto mining companies a tax incentive, they just look at you like, no. I mean, it was very easy for them to make a decision. They didn't know what we were talking about. So then we were looking at, trying to find examples for them and just showing them that it's really a part of everything that's going on in business right now, and data centers and data storage and cybersecurity. So all of those things, it was really an education process. We didn't have enough time to do it, to get them up to speed on what it was. And they eventually, it was still a scary thing to them. The communities were looking at same thing, basically. They're really understanding of the fact that North Dakota, South Dakota, Minnesota have labor issues. We can't, and in all of our towns, virtually, with the exception of a handful, we just don't have a labor force. So data mining is really ideal for some of these small towns. I typically use the pitch that, hey, we can do a megawatt data center. We could do 10 of them in a 60-mile radius, and you could employ one or two people that aren't going to have to drive 45 miles to go to work. They can work in their hometown that they like to stay. They will, they can service those 10 locations in a hub and spoke type business model. And we just don't have the employees to do a large, we can't do an Amazon, we can't do 100, employee build out in most of our small towns. So they're very receptive of that. The data center thing right now is really intriguing to me. That is something that I've had a couple of conversations with people on the data center inquiries that are, I just think it's incredible. That's to me a little less scary than the data mining, a little less risky, whether it's a utility perspective or a community perspective. We're going to, continue to entertain those inquiries and see what we can do. One thing we do have in our in Otter Tail is, we have buildings available in these small towns, and we don't need to build a data center that's going to employ 100 people. We can build a data center habit or move into a b existing building that can do data storage for several clients. And I just think that's something that's, I'm hearing a little bit more that's starting to move away from the big city data center applications out into rural America. And that's really attractive to me, and I think to our company too.
Well, and you're touching on a piece that I'm finding more and more important in these conversations is that positive economic impact to the local community. And making sure that the customers, Bitcoin mining, crypto mining, or just data centers, when they're approaching you and Otter Tail, is to make sure that there's a tie-in for that positive economic impact. And it even goes a step farther. I mean, these communities could look at having repair centers. So there are not a lot of places that people can send a Bitcoin mining computer, like the one sitting behind me, that can get repaired. There's just not a lot of them. So there are ways to get certified to do this. And then you could have people in town servicing. You could have employees, like you said, a 10 megawatt site, even if that's spread out over, a couple of different locations, that could take on five, six employees. So yeah, it's definitely an important piece and component to these conversations. So it's good to hear that you guys are already doing that. You're bringing that ahead of the customer inquiries.
You know, it's, again, I've been with Autotail nearly 40 years, but involved in economic development for virtually all of that time in one aspect or another. And you hit on a couple of things there, Ben, that just haven't seemed to have changed. You know, you look at what we used to do 20 years ago in economic development was you try to bring a business in and then see what kind of spin-offs can be derived from that. So if you bring in a nice manufacturing business, what else do they do? What do they do that they might have to ship off somewhere else? This is no different. You're exactly right. But people just don't know what it is, right? So in South Dakota, I'm a huge technical school fan, mainly because from our industry as a customer service and operations guy for almost my entire life, they're so easy to work with, right? And they're so nimble. And so you can go to them and say, you know, we need a program. We've got this industry coming. Can you develop a program for us to train these people to take these jobs? And they do it like that. I mean, they're so eager to do those types of things. So we can do that. And we're doing that in South Dakota. We're doing it in North Dakota, Minnesota too. It's just, we work really closely with the tech schools to let them know what types of industry needs are. Just an example, another area that really, really fascinates me that I think there's tremendous opportunity for rural America is cybersecurity. Dakota State University in Madison, South Dakota, received funding to build a massive cybersecurity training center. And, they also received some funding to build a cybersecurity center in Sioux Falls, South Dakota, that these people once trained can go to work there. There is no reason why they can't go to work in hometown, South Dakota, North Dakota, Minnesota, and do cybersecurity and not have to drive to Sioux Falls or some other community they don't want to live in. So I think that's another area where, because everyone needs it. Everyone thinks they've got great cybersecurity, but it's not always true. I've had people tell me horror stories about their cybersecurity, and we hear about them every day. But there are kids out there, I think, that could do this. We just need to open those doors. And, for the work I've done with schools over the years, a lot of times they're just not aware. And as businesses, we've got to work with schools and tech schools and the Regental system to say, hey, this all is changing. And you might not like it. It's maybe not traditional, but guess what? This is where it's going. And, we're a smaller utility again. We move really slow. We're not ever the first in any arena. But we also understand that it's changing, and it's not attracting the same kind of industry that we were once trying to attract years and years and years ago. So now it's again, we are seeing opportunity for unprecedented load growth. That's a good thing for us. It's a good thing for the rest of our customers, and loads like this, whether it's in particular data mining. The flexibility to interrupt is absolutely, it's just great for us. Bring them on and being able to interrupt them at times when we need to. Yeah, it's just tremendous benefit for a utility company.
I would love it if you would maybe expand on that interruptible part a little bit more and why that's such an attractive piece, especially, this is what I'm mostly interested in is you're seeing this load growth. And with load growth, I'm making some assumptions here, but you will have to build out infrastructure to facilitate that load growth. Can you talk to how important the interruptible part is? And then maybe does that pertain to the load growth and building out new infrastructure?
I can talk a little bit. I'm not an engineer. I'm not a transmission studies specialist, but at Otter Tail and a lot of utilities for as long as I can remember, interruptibility has been a critical part to what they do. For every megawatt you can interrupt, that's a megawatt you don't have to build. So you're just able to work the system very well. You're not adding additional generation resources, which are incredibly expensive. But on the locate side of things, again, going back to where can we locate this that's going to be the cheapest, right? Where we're not going to have to build miles of transmission, where we can just find this spot. I equate it a lot to the wind industry, and people might disagree with me, but the wind industry is pretty developed, and they were looking for sweet spots in the transmission. Data and data centers, I think, are the same thing. Where can they find those sweet spots where there's available capacity? And hey, we can also help you if we can locate there. You can have the ability to control our load when you need to. Economics, capacity reasons. And we're okay with that. We can go from 100 megawatts down to 3 within 10 minutes. And that's just awesome. We really
And
like that kind of load.
it's not like a big manufacturing plant where you're going to
Correct.
ruin, lines of equipment by doing that.
Yeah, and it's that they're basically they're volunteering to do it. We also have rates that will give them the opportunity to control, essentially control their destiny, right? Destiny. They can go on a particular rate and say, well, if we can stay within this band and operate within this band, we can get the lowest rate. But if we need to move into the next band, it's going to be a little bit higher. It's basically peak, off-peak, and shoulder times of the day. So they can manage that on their own to help them, have the achieve the lowest cost on the electric side.
Yeah, and it, I mean it, that is such an attractive ability for a Bitcoin miner specifically, because as the price of Bitcoin goes up and things become more profitable for the operation, they can start to look at the peak hours and the shoulder and say, we're just going to run right through this because we're still going to be profitable even at this new, blended rate. And then when the price drops, or there's difficulty and network hash rate involved with the Bitcoin mining industry. And so if those start to jump up and make profitability less, then they can get back into the off-peak hours. Or yeah, so it's an incredible offering for a Bitcoin mining company. Kevin,
Yeah,
maybe just
once.
to switch gears, sorry, just
Sure. No,
to
go ahead.
switch gears a little bit. And talk about some of this interest being in economic development. What is the interest? Are you still fielding a ton of calls on this, or what does the interest look like?
It was probably up to about 6 months ago. I would wager to bet I was taking at least one or two calls a week from different companies. It's less now. Still spend a lot of my week when I'm in peer and when I'm not working on the legislation, and I'm working with potential clients right now that are seem to be more in it for the long run, that aren't just looking for certain, looking for those load pockets where they can get capacity. They're looking at specific facilities, specific sites. There's more. There's a seems to be developing more local interest in bit mining, and then the data center topics. I that's picked up in the last 2 months. That seems to be a hot topic that I'm getting calls from people that are looking at that concept and where can they go. And I think the Dakotas and Minnesota, it's starting to become I know they're getting more aggressive. The states, the North Dakota in particular, their governor is extremely aggressive towards data in general. And South Dakota, we've got a pretty good data center. I mean, a lot of companies have that, but it's going to be really interesting. I think it, you know, the market on Bitcoin certainly drives a good portion of it, but I'm getting a lot of local inquiries right now asking about where could we site? What do you have available?
It's great to hear. I mean, it's really encouraging. It's really encouraging to hear that because it is a tough environment on the Bitcoin mining side of things. And, you know, another thing, and maybe you can touch on this a little bit more too, from your perspective what I'm hearing is there's kind of this disconnect between timelines and expectations. I think the Bitcoin mining community, you know, give you a call. Hey, Kevin, I want, you know, 5-10 megawatts. Can we do that in 3 months?
That's a great question. Yeah. I just got off prior to this. I was just on a call with a client that was talking about the exact same thing. How fast can I get to the market? You know, I need to get there now. And inevitably, depending upon size, of course, you know, depending upon the equipment needs. I mean, we're just held hostage to those, you know, lead times for equipment. No utility that I know of ramps up for what are the possibilities? What are we looking at down the road? We build to the existing load, maybe a little bit extra. So we don't have a ton of equipment, a ton of transformers. We have transformers in stock that we think we would need if we had a catastrophic storm of some type, right? Mm-hmm. So we're not ramped up to do, you know, have a bunch of transformers available or protection equipment available for a company that wants to come in at a larger size, even at a smaller size, even at 5 megawatts. I mean, that's, you know, lead times on equipment for that are out there a year. And so that's disturbing to many people that think that you should be able to go faster. Well, we would love to. It's just that we can't. And so, you know, that's why I'm a big small miner fan, because we may have areas out there where that, you know, we might be able to do more for less type of thing where we can get you going faster. But, you know, again, if we need to add equipment and infrastructure, we're a small company. We have a workforce plan that needs to be addressed, right? We have to do these things, that upgrades and storm replacements, and with a very small staff. So when you drop in a big project, it just is, again, it gets back to that human resource management problem that you just don't have the bodies to go get this all done. So you have to say, okay, which is going to come first? We're going to replace this line over here, or are we going to, you know, build a new line? So yeah, it's a really tough balancing act. And but we've, so far it's been pretty good so far. And, you know, I would say for us right now, we're probably going to sit and pause a little bit on some of these projects until we can get some of the other stuff, you know, ironed out, get it to the point where we can start relying on our employees to kind of move on to some other stuff. So it's a busy, busy time right now.
Oh yeah. You guys had, and I think I saw an article on this, so correct me if I'm wrong. Are you guys, you're expanding your transmission, right? Or are you upgrading? I can't remember what the article said. You were either upgrading or expanding. So are you guys growing your generation right now? Is that part of that?
No, the expansion you're talking about is through, they're basically multi-value projects. And years ago, there was like 17 projects that came out, and two of those projects were in our service territory. One went from Big Stone Power Plant, which is in Northeast South Dakota, went down south along the border to a community named Brookings, South Dakota, and then it went east to the Twin Cities. And then we had another one that went from Big Stone to across South Dakota, central South Dakota, then went north into North Dakota. So those are two what they call multi-value projects. So A lot of utilities involved, a lot of states involved. So very beneficial to customers and all of the MISO or Midwest Independent System Operator footprint. We're going kind of through a second round right now of those types of projects. So we have a couple of them, and I'm probably going to get one right, and I'm not even going to talk about the other because I'm not as familiar. But another one that will go from Big Stone north to Alexandria, and then another one that's going to go not positive. I think that one's up in North Dakota. So yeah, one thing that's happening is, you know, there's all of the wind that's getting built. You know, it's the transmission system capacities are limited. So we know we're going to see more renewables. And so MISO and the utilities in the states are really looking at, okay, how can we expand the transmission? Where does it need to go? And that type of thing. So yeah, those are coming up and there will be significant expansions. I remember a few years ago when we gave the governor of South Dakota an update on the Big Stone to Brookings and the Big Stone to Ellendale 345 kV transmission line updates. And at the time we gave the update, there was 2,000 megawatts of capacity available, and it was virtually all subscribed to. And she made the comment, well, why didn't you build them bigger? Which I thought was a great question. And so for a governor that's probably, you know, utilities and the transmission isn't on top of her list, she asked a great question. So, yeah, so there it's a big deal right now, and lots going on the transmission side across the country.
That's cool. And I mean, that, you know, inevitably works its way into your arena when you're looking for bringing new customers to your grid.
So, and then you look at, you know, the transmission and I'm not an expert on the transmission at all, but I hear a lot about congestion on that transmission. And that, I think, too, is another thing that is another opportunity. If you've got an area where there's, like in Northeast South Dakota, a lot of wind, but the transmission system is congested, how can you, and so then those wind facilities, those projects are being curtailed to shut down when, you know, they could be producing just because of the transmission congestion. That's my understanding to in a very simplistic way.
Yeah.
So how can we find, you know, potentials that want to go to those points in the where there's congestion and tap into that and allow those projects to keep, you know.
Yeah. Are those assets Otter Tails? I mean, or are those private wind turbines that are then feeding into the grid, or?
Yeah, they're not. We don't have any wind resources in South Dakota, but other companies, other investor-owned utilities, are owning those facilities, and so they're some of them are getting to be older, but they're still operable and can still function, but they're being curtailed, and that's just, I'm guessing, not a very good thing for the utility that has them shut down.
So. Oh, I would imagine. And where I was going with that question was, if you saw, and I know that this is a little speculative, but if you saw any potential there for like an Otter Tail to own, you know, a container filled with Bitcoin miners that they could deploy, so there's congestion on the transmission line, instead of curtailing the wind turbines, maybe we bring, you know, this container out there, we don't have to turn the turbine off, and we can monetize that excess instead of turning it off. Are those conversations happening at like the Otter Tails of the world or other utility companies?
Oh, absolutely. Yeah. I've even had inquiries talking about that very thing. You know, what's going to be amazing to me, and again, utility companies are 100 years old and strapped with, or, you know, with tradition and very cautious, risk averse. Because we, you know, get a rate of return, and we need to make sure our rates are competitive. And but yeah, those types of situations are going to require almost a complete different mindset on how we operate and how we you know, just how that whole thing is going to work. There's all kinds of talks about the generation, how that's going to work, and it's just the industry is going through a huge. It's mind blowing to hear the different types of things people want to do. And so again, you got to try to keep up with that.
Yeah.
And then you got to try to develop your rate structure to be able to get it approved. And then, you know, we were regulated by the public utilities commissions or service commissions in the states. So yeah, it's fascinating. It's mind boggling, but it's going to happen. And we're doing the best we can to talk with those customers to figure out what their needs are and see what we can do to try to help them, because it's going to happen somewhere. We'd love to be a part of it. We'd love to work with them. We're not afraid of those types of things.
Mm-hmm.
You know, and that's kind of evidenced by just us being in the bit mining industry. We want to work with those people. So it's going to be fun for the next few years to figure out what's going on.
I think what's part of it. Yeah. Well, it's really cool to hear that perspective. So I appreciate that. What's fun and exciting is, like you said, this is a very old industry, and it does have old mindset and mentality around the industry. And then you're starting to see a shift in the thinking. And, you know, some new opportunities that are arising that, you know, aren't looking as risky anymore. Bitcoin's been around for 14 years. I'm starting to sort, you know, to feel established enough to lean into that industry. Data center, you know, you want to talk about the direction of the future, data, internet. I mean, that's all becoming more and more. COVID showed us that with all the virtual work. And just what we can do virtually. So to lean into that it's great to hear that the industry is starting to talk about it. Did you, or were people from Otter Tail out at DistribuTech in California last week by any chance?
I'm not familiar with it. I haven't heard anything about that. No.
Okay. It's an industry event, for utilities. And it's very forward thinking, very, you know, looking at the latest and greatest technologies and ideas and things like that. And this year, I know that there were at least two Bitcoin mining companies that were set up there to start talking about integration. How do we vertically integrate something like this? So it's cool to see those conversations taking place.
Yeah. It's going to be amazing. It's going to change. I think it's going to change the industry a ton. And, you know, we're going to, again, I hope we're a part of it, because it's fascinating. It's just fascinating. So,
yeah. Well, as we're kind of wrapping up our conversation here, just to be respectful of time, it's funny how fast an hour can go. One last question I had for you is, you know, from your perspective on the economic development side and from the legislative side, what do you think the biggest miss is when a Bitcoin mining company is approaching a utility company?
I think right now for us, it's really kind of a fledgling industry for us. There's just a lot of people that are in the industry that want to get in, right? And I'll say this just from my personal perspective, being in customer service and operations, I'm not an engineer. I don't understand the voltage and flows and what, blah, 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 blah. But I do understand, you know, where we want to go and what we want to do. I think one of the biggest misses is, you know, if you're looking to go out to a utility, could be wrong, they'll recognize the tire kickers and they'll see that pretty quickly. The ones that you know, ask the right questions, right? They We're going to ask right up front, what type of voltage are you looking at operating at? And if they're not able to talk that language or have somebody there that can talk that language, it starts off, I think, a little bit shaky. There's many others that are going to, what I do is I get the initial contacts and then I bring them together with more people at OtterTail. And I want to bring them together with people that can talk technically, mm-hmm. whether it's rate structure or engineering side, transmission, distribution. And if they don't have that ability to talk that language, it's going to be a tough start. It's going to be a waste of some time. And that turns our people maybe a little bit sideways. So if there's a big miss so far that I've seen, that's it. We've got a lot of people out there, a lot of interest that seem to be a lot further along and they know what they're doing. So that so far for me has been a slight miss. It's not something you can't overcome, but they're not always, if they're small, they're not always ready to ask those big questions. And utilities are going to be very, I think, I'll speak for OtterTail, we're very risk averse. So we're going to make sure that we are going to be, we're going to look at, we're going to ask for some cash, right? You're certainly yeah. not going to go into this free. It's a business that right now from a utility perspective, risky and portable. And seems like, we don't want to be left out all of a sudden holding a receivable that's just tremendous, just massive. So we're very careful there. So that too, they don't maybe see that coming if they're small and new to the industry, but most of the established players, they fully get it. They understand, they've done it before. That to me is what I've noticed over the last couple of years.
Okay. What I like about ending on that note, Kevin, is that kind of helps give perspective and insight for people who are interested in, maybe moving from the garage to, a megawatt and that's a big jump, by the way. I know that people talk about moving into a megawatt or 10 megawatts. Like that's, a very easy thing. That's a substantial jump. But it helps people understand, maybe where they need to get the education and where they need to kind of sharpen the pencil before they come knocking on the door and say, well, I'd like 10 megawatts in 3 months, please. So yeah, I appreciate that.
I think everyone's in the same boat, man. I know, the supply chains have been tough on everybody and COVID was tough on everybody, but I'm hoping someday in the near future that changes and we get back to the way it was where we can move quicker, more nimbly with new customers. I go back to my earlier statement. It's frustrating to me as an economic developer to have to go to someone and say, hey, we're going to take a pause here. We aren't going to move on. And that's really, again, unprecedented times we're living in right now. And as a, somebody that has worked for utility for nearly 40 years, I know how hard it was to work for 500 kW of load 20 years ago, and we were growing at 1-2% a year. And now we're at this point where, but it takes a ton of people. It takes a ton of thought. And then we got to also remember that we're regulated. So everything we do is going to be under a microscope. So we want to make sure we're making really good, prudent decisions on what mm-hmm. we're doing, where we're going. Because it can make a huge difference.
So. Yeah, absolutely. Kevin, I really appreciate your time today. I know that between the legislative work and your other work, you're very busy. So you've been very graceful with your time. I appreciate that. Before we end, I do want to make sure I give you a chance to share contact information or how people can get in touch with you if they want to sure. either learn more or maybe they're interested in, a location. So if you're comfortable sharing contact information, absolutely. How to get in touch with you.
Yeah, I pretty much go on my cell phone and everybody does. So it's not unusual. My cell phone number for anybody that's interested is area code 605-880-0975. email KOUB@OT.com.
And we'll put all that in the show notes for you too.
I always love that because when I was flying, occasionally flying on our company plane, my dear friend Randy Kinder would say, Oscar Tango Papa was his call sign when he was flying in. So, but yeah, and then if you go onto the website, OttertailOTPCO.com OTPCO.com, there's an economic development tab in there too. You can go on that. It also gives information on our sales team. So if you're looking at a particular area in mind, they will certainly take your calls too. Our customer service centers are located throughout our service territory. You can feel free to give them a call and they'll pass it on to us and the sales team. So.
Awesome. Well, again, thank you, Kevin. Appreciate the time. This was an absolute pleasure.
My pleasure. Thanks, Ben. Appreciate it.
Take care.
Take care. Bye-bye.